We're in Salisbury, Rhodesia, and during the next hour, we'll be talking to Prime Minister Ian Smith. He is the most, one of the most controversial prime ministers in the non-communist world, the head of a very controversial government. He has a number of things to say about the Salisbury situation and the Rhodesian situation, which I think you will find interesting.
The following, in black and white, is a repeat of a program originally telecast on April 28, 1974.
Mr. Ian Smith is the Prime Minister of Rhodesia, an office to which he was elected in 1964 as the great crisis approached with Great Britain. The white Rhodesians surveying the proliferation of black independent countries around them, including the two former partners in the Federation of Rhodesia, wanted independence for themselves. And indeed, as a practical matter, Rhodesia had been self-governing since 1923. But the government of Mr. Smith, the Rhodesian Front, spoke only for the white population of Rhodesia, a bare 250,000 people, 5% of the population, and Westminster said no. Whereupon at 11:15 a.m. on November the 11th, 1965, the government issued a unilateral declaration of independence, the UDI, the second such declaration by a former colony in Britain's history, the first being our very own, which was signed before the word unilateral was invented. England instantly branded UDI illegal, imposed boycotts, in which she was joined by many other countries. In 1965, 66, and 67, the United Nations voted sanctions against Rhodesia. To this day, her government is not recognized diplomatically by any country. All attempts at reconciliation with Great Britain have foundered on the issue of the treatment of the black majority. Ian Smith was born and went to school here. During the war, he was among the dozen most conspicuously valiant soldiers. As a pilot, a partisan, a guerrilla fighter, after one accident, his entire face was recomposed by plastic surgeons. He returned to Rhodesia, completed his work at Rhodes University, entered politics, and was voted leader of a party which soon captured all the white seats in Parliament. Twice he was on the verge of successfully negotiating an agreement. Most recently and most spectacularly, he was rebuffed by the black Rhodesians who rejected the proposed concordat with Great Britain. He stands now as the head of a country beleaguered by economic sanctions and terrorist night riders. He is apparently unflinching. I should like to ask the Prime Minister, what would happen if in Rhodesia, if say over the next 4 or 5 years, the vote in fact were given to every literate resident?
Well, I think a lot, excuse me, a lot would depend on your definition of a literate resident. It is a fact that we still have quite a large number of our indigenous people, the African black people, who have had a very scanty education. I do want to make that clear, and we have never denied this. However, we are doing our utmost to try to ensure that we give more and more of them a better and a better education. But we have got the tremendous problem that up to the time of the last war that you referred to, the majority of these people were not interested in education. In fact, you couldn't drag them to a school. After the war, there came about a revolution, and most of them decided that they would like to have an education. But as no doubt you are aware, this is easier said than done. There is the tremendous practical problem of providing the means to educate the people, the wherewithal. And not only the need to build, not only the bricks and the mortar, but of course without teachers to teach the children, then there isn't much point in providing the buildings. We pride ourselves on the fact that it is accepted. We give our African people a better standard of education in Rhodesia than any other country in Africa to the north of us. So I think this is an indication of how much we have tried and to what extent we have succeeded.
Well, you haven't made clear to what extent you have succeeded. What is the literacy rate in Rhodesia in the black population at this point?
Well, it's very difficult, again, to be precise. As far as most of the older Africans are concerned, the majority of them never saw the inside of a school. But today, there are very few who don't see the inside of a school. And we do believe in fairly high standards. I think this is the crux of our policy. We believe that democracy is a responsible thing, that people who take part in it should acknowledge this responsibility, and therefore we have high qualifications, both educational and financial. So really, in answer to your question, we don't like the idea of one man, one vote, and even if we did accept it, it would take quite a long time, I believe, where the average African would be sufficiently educated to be able to make an intelligent contribution.
Well, I understand what you say, but I'm anxious to pursue the following distinction. I think most Americans, for instance, are sympathetic with the idea of a literacy test, which we had until quite recently. It was a qualification that was held to be illegal in the South because the thought was that it was abused, that people who were actually illiterate were nevertheless being denied the franchise. But it still strikes most people as a reasonable qualification. And when people talk about the disfranchisement of all of the black people, the point is very seldom made, but how many of those in fact meet standards which white people are required to meet? And that's why I'm anxious to hear from you. What is the effective disfranchisement of people who in fact here in Rhodesia would meet the qualifications that a white man has to meet in order to vote? Is it 5%, 10%, 15%?
I would say, but this is a
guess.
Yeah. You must please accept that. I would say that at the moment it is around about 20-25%.
Uh-huh. Now, let me rephrase the question. What would happen if that 20 or 25% were given an effective franchise equal to the franchise exercised by the whites?
Well, they are entitled to that. There is nothing to stop them. It is a fact that the African lives under a different system to the one that we live in. The Western democratic system is something which is foreign to our Africans. They live under what is known as the tribal system. And they have their elected chief and the headman and the kraal head. And that person is their elected leader, you might say, and he represents them. And they accept the decision which comes from the council. And we find that they are not very interested in our system and very lethargic about taking advantage of the opportunities which are offered to them.
Well, what are the opportunities that are offered to them? Can they vote without distinction of color,
yes,
assuming that they can establish their literacy?
Yes, they have exactly the same right that I have.
Well, now, are a certain number of seats in Parliament reserved for white occupants?
We have certain seats for whites and certain seats for blacks.
And what is the number in each case?
Well, there is nothing to stop the Africans having as many seats as the Europeans if they would qualify and come on for the vote. But they do have one peculiar preference which the Europeans or the white people don't have. There are special seats which are entrenched for them on a lower qualification, that is 16 seats out of a house of 66. But in addition to that, they are entitled to come on and obtain as many seats as the white man, providing they take the trouble to qualify.
I see. So therefore, hypothetically, the 25% of the blacks who are literate, should they all exercise their vote, could in fact fill all 66 seats. Because in fact, 25% of 5 million is more than 250,000.
No, that isn't strictly the position. At the moment, under our constitution, the parliament is divided between black and white.
Oh, so certain seats are reserved for whites only?
Yes.
How many?
Well, half and half.
33 are reserved. 33 must be white, is that it?
No, 50. Now, the Africans, as they come onto the roll, could earn and win up to 50 seats so that we got to a stage of parity. But at the moment, they enjoy 16 seats without earning them. Mm-hmm. Now, as they earn their seats, these 16 would count. And the ultimate would be a position where they would earn 50 seats, and the Europeans, the white people, would earn 50 seats.
And that is a technical possibility when?
It's very difficult to predict this because of the imponderables that I have mentioned to you, the fact that they seem uninterested in our political system. No doubt time will change this, but at the moment, it looks a long way off.
Well, theoretically then, let's see if I understand you correctly. Theoretically, in your next election, which must be within 18 months, assuming mirabile dictu, that all literate black Rhodesians voted, they would have absolute parity in the parliament. 50 seats for them and 50 seats for you.
That is correct.
The 69 constitution to which I take it you are alluding,
yes,
you were prepared to modify how in 1971 when you met with Alec Douglas Hume and initialed a reform?
There were a number of points. Probably the most important ones were the manner in which people earn their right to seats in Parliament. At the moment, this depends on one's earning ability, one's financial contribution towards the fiscus of the country. Under the new suggested constitution, that yardstick is eliminated, and in its stead, we bring in a straight financial and educational qualification.
Could you describe that, Mr. Smith?
Well, for example, if you have a Form 2 education, if you know what that means 2 years in the secondary school, what we call senior school. It is, I suppose, standard 7 if you start right from the beginning. If you have 2 years of that, plus an earning capacity of around about $1,800 per annum, you qualify. If you have a higher educational qualification, 4 years secondary school instead of the 2 years that I mentioned, then your financial qualification drops from around about 1,800 per annum to, I think it's about 1,200 per annum.
Now, you're talking about the 69 or the 71 proposal?
71.
Proposal, I see.
Yes.
Now, this would modify the 69 arrangement in what way?
Well, it would facilitate the position as far as the Africans are concerned. Black people, it would make it easier for them to come on to the roll and to gain more seats in Parliament.
Well, what I now don't know is what are the financial requirements under the 69 constitution?
Well, the financial...
1,800 for the 71 one.
The same financial qualifications apply to obtaining the vote.
I see.
But it is the earning of seats in Parliament which has changed. Mm-hmm. Under the present situation, the 69 situation, the seats are earned dependent on the contribution towards the national exchequer. Mm-hmm. Whereas under the new setup, that is completely eliminated. And the only factor which governs seats in Parliament is the number of people who come onto the roll in keeping with this qualification that I mentioned.
I understand. Now, how many black Rhodesians earn $1,800 or more per year, would you say?
Well, I would say it's around about the sort of figure that I mentioned to you, I should think.
About 25%?
Yes.
So as things now stand, the 25% who earn $1,800 probably coincide with the 18% who are literate, correct? I mean,
yes.
There's a rough correlation there.
Yes,
there.
Yes.
And of that 25%, what percentage would you say, in fact, bother to vote? 5% of those,
about
10%?
About 5%, I would think.
Now, do you think that this is... largely because of these tribal traditions you have described, or is it a feeling of impotence that results from their feeling that this is a white society governed by white people for the benefit of white people?
I don't believe that they are influenced by that. There are a few who are politically motivated, yes, the agitators, the political leaders, I don't deny this, but the vast majority of them openly say, we've always lived under a system where you have governed the country and we're satisfied with what you have done. We are happy under our tribal system. Why don't you leave us alone? And quite frankly, when you go amongst them and see how they live, I think it is debatable as to whether our system is better than theirs.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's got to be some reason for the consternation that the mere mention of Rhodesia causes in many parts of the world. There is a general conviction that it is a racist society run for the benefit of white people. Now, this could be objectively true, irrespective of the question of whether the excluded blacks were perfectly contented. You would acknowledge that, wouldn't you?
Yes, I accept that this is a situation that exists, but I believe wrongly so. I think most of our critics have never taken the trouble to come here and find out the facts for themselves. It is interesting to note that the system that we now run has satisfied the British government, it did in the past, and only a year or two ago it satisfied Sir Alec Douglas Hume as the representative of the then Conservative government. They told us that they thought it was a very fair and a reasonable constitution.
Well, but you said that it satisfies the black community, and yet, in fact, the Pierce Commission found otherwise, didn't they?
Well, I think this is debatable. Pierce himself admitted that he saw less than 5% of the people, so it's difficult to assess opinion under similar circumstances.
George Gallup sees less than 0.5% of the people, and he's seldom off by more than 1%.
Well, unfortunately, I don't think this was carried out in the way that a Gallup poll should be carried out. This was carried out only amongst a very small section of the people, and they were mainly the dissidents, the people who were stirring things up. The great mass of the people, the contented Africans, were never consulted at all. I think the essence of a Gallup poll is that you must get a sample from all sections. That was where Pierce failed.
Well, you get a sample in the Gallup poll depending on what it is that you seek to accomplish. If you are trying to predict an election, then you sample voters, because obviously there's no point in sampling non-voting sentiment if you try to predict an election. Now, were these, let me ask you this, what could be the motives of the Pierce Commission in traducing their mandate? Their mandate, as I take it, was to find out whether, in fact, the people were enthusiastic about this.
Yes. Well, I don't believe they carried out the exercise in the correct manner. Unfortunately, I believe they found themselves the victims of the political agitators who went from meeting to meeting, first of all having prepared the ground and carried out quite a large amount of intimidation. And I think it's difficult for people who don't understand Rhodesia to understand that it is so very easy to intimidate people who live under the circumstances in which we find our African people. And this is precisely what happened. There were gangs of agitators who went from meeting to meeting. This was quite clear on all of the evidence that was produced, and they were seeing the same people time after time. In fact, some of the Pierce commissioners themselves commented on this.
Well, Ms. Smith, let me ask you for a little historical perspective here. After all, I come from a country that had slaves up until 100 years ago, and from a country that didn't permit a black man to play baseball until 1940 or whatever it was, so that I would be completely sympathetic with you if you objected that other people are always applying standards that are only freshly arrived at in their own case. But mightn't it have been said 120 years ago in America that the slaves are perfectly happy, that they don't want emancipation, that Nat Turner was, after all, an anomaly? To what extent do you feel, as a civilized Rhodesian, a part of the Western tradition, that you have a responsibility to stimulate an appetite for political equality?
Well, I believe that this is something that must be evolutionary. I think you turn this into a revolution to your detriment. You see...
No, I don't believe in revolution either, but...
Well, I'm just making my position quite clear.
Yeah.
What a lot of people don't understand is that really the advent of the European and his civilization to this part of the world only stems from about the beginning of the century. Mm-hmm. It's a very short time. And in that time, I repeat, we have done more for our African people than any other country in the African continent to the north of us. And they had their civilizations and the advent of the European there before they came to Rhodesia. For some reason or other, we were left right until the end. So I do say this in defense of what we have done here. Now, what people have got to accept is that of our African population, I doubt whether there are more than about 5% who really understand the meaning of a constitution as such under our democratic system. While they've had a certain amount of education and they can read and write and so on, the constitution and the political aspects are different. Now, I have heard many constitutional experts say that this 71 constitution that we produced here, we and the British government, is probably one of the most complicated constitutions that this world has ever seen. Now, how can you ask a mass of people who don't understand what even a simple constitution is, whether they approve of a complicated constitution and whether they think it's the right one or not for their country? This is the predicament in which we found ourselves.
But that's the predicament of all democracies. Let me shoot something at you. There was a recent poll conducted in America, great length, and it was discovered that only 60% of the American voters know the names of their two senators, or know the names of one senator. Only 40% know the names of both senators, and only 25% believe that the Supreme Court is a branch of Congress. So, but democracy, as I understand it, is not really a political intelligence test. Thank God, otherwise we'd all be run by professors from Harvard University. But it is a means of saying no. And don't you imagine that in Rhodesia, as in America, most of the people who vote on the general business of whether they think well of you, and whether they think you're leading them in the right direction,
not because of
an intimate knowledge of your constitution.
I would go along with that, and perhaps to a large extent they vote on party lines. But these are people who have been brought up with and who understand the democratic system of government. I repeat, when you think that 70 years ago, most of these people had never seen a European or any Western civilization. They have not received any education in the democratic system of government. They are not interested in the democratic system of government. The American people basically have always lived under the system. Now, we are dealing with people who say, but we don't understand this thing that the white man has brought here. We live under the tribal system. We're quite happy. We're peaceful. Why don't you leave us alone? What do you say to them? You can't be left alone and peaceful. Whether you like it or not, you must come in and play a part with us. It's not an easy question.
Well, I'm very much very interested in your views on that, because I happen to believe that the pretensions of democracy tended to be oversold in the 19th century and under Woodrow Wilson. But this is an argument that is not to be confused with the position that you oughtn't consciously to attempt to stimulate an interest in self-government.
Well, we do this. I think I made it clear to you. We do encourage these people to come in and take part. We have a system whereby we are educating them through a lower strata of government, rural councils, the same as you have your local government, as you do even under your American constitution, I think. So for a long time we have been doing this. We've been educating them and stimulating them. And you know, quite a few of our people have got around the world a bit. They've seen how the rest of the world lives. Most important of all, they have gone to some of these countries to the north of us. And they have seen what the white man and his type of politics has done for those countries. You know, this magic term, one man, one vote, that all these countries shouted for. And many of the European countries in the world evidently thought it was necessary to give them this. For some reason or other, they seemed to have a bit of a guilt conscience over what the white man had done in Africa. With us, we're the very reverse. But I think the fact is in these countries to the north of us that while they started off with this wonderful thing of one man, one vote, they only had it once. Mm-hmm. Because thereafter it became a one-party state, which in other words is virtually a dictatorship. Many of our African people have got enough sense to realize that that could happen here if we went too fast. In other words, if we changed what we believe should be an evolutionary system into a revolution.
Well, I think I understand what you say, but it becomes very difficult to adjudicate this question without some knowledge of A, are there spokesmen for the black community here? B, how do we know that they are authentic spokesmen? And C, what are they saying? Now, Bishop Matsuriwa, am I pronouncing his name right?
Yes.
As I understand it, he was opposed to the 1971 compromise, was he not? To what extent is he a spokesman of the African community?
Well, I believe he represents a section of African opinion, yes. But I think it's very difficult to assess his position truly at the moment, because this organization which he represents has not come forth into the party political field and contested an election as such. So it is difficult to know. We have a number of other African political parties. I repeat to you, they have 16 members of parliament sitting in our parliament today. And in addition to that, we have the tribal structure, which works up to the headman and the chief. We have a council of chiefs in Rhodesia, with these, most of them elderly, distinguished gentlemen who meet with the government and give us benefit of their views on how they think we should run the country. They have representations which the white man does not have. I believe that they have a very wide means of representing their views.
Well, I think that it is quite true that if the 250,000 white people in Rhodesia were to awake tomorrow with black skins, there would be absolutely no resentment over the fact that 5% of the country was really governing 95%. This would be rather more than in most African states. But that which reinforces the racial point really is the social habits of that 5%, probably more, in my judgment, in my experience as an American, probably more than the fact of your political domination. Now, isn't it true that in the last few years you have come up with a whole series of petty apartheid type regulations that are infinitely infuriating to a lot of black Rhodesians?
No, I regret to say that this is a story which the news media have put over, but it is a complete distortion of the situation. The African in this country has a lot more privileges and is a lot freer today than he was 10 years ago when this government came to power. And I can produce any number of black people who will vouch for this fact. We introduced a couple of pieces of controversial legislation, one of them particularly to do with our security situation, which involved the carrying of identification certificates. Now, this is legislation which has been in existence in Rhodesia for over 40 years.
A white and black, or just
black? No, only black. And we've had this for 40 years. And one of the original reasons for introducing this was to ensure that the African, who in those days, the vast majority could neither read nor write, had a certificate on which the terms of his employment were written down. In other words, his contract of employment. And this was for his protection. The average white man could look after himself. Now, I repeat, we've had this for 40 years. Now, what we did was to close a small loophole which had been thrown up because of the terrorist incursion which we have in a small corner to the north of our country. You see, I think it is worth pointing out that we have over 250,000 alien Africans who come to work in our country. A few years ago, it was 500,000. Africans who come from these countries surrounding us to the north. The politicians there claim that we don't give our black man a fair deal. But it's a funny thing that we have all of these Africans who leave those countries and prefer to come and work in this country and live in this country.
And what was the loophole?
The loophole was that these people were not carrying these identification certificates. Well, now, we made it clear quite a few years ago that it was our intention to make it obligatory for all Rhodesians, white and black, to carry these. And this is our intention. It is simply a case of getting around to the mechanics of bringing it in, the finances and the machines and so on.
I mean, it's a form of immigration control, really?
No, it's a form of identification of people within this country as well. The same as I believe Americans carry identification certificates, don't they?
No. In a word.
Well, I met an American once who told
Although
me that
we didn't invent the passport.
Yes, I met an American once who told me that he did, and he produced his certificate with his photograph on it.
It was probably an American Express card or something.
Maybe.
But you have to qualify for that. Could you describe, Mr. Prime Minister, what it is of a social character that a black Rhodesian may not do? I know that your colleges are integrated, your universities, correct? What about your secondary schools?
We have a thing that is known as a Land Apportionment Act or a Land Tenure Act. And again, this is something that we've had ever since we've had a Rhodesia here. It was something that the British government was party to. And when we obtained our virtual independence, or responsible government, in 1923, this came in as part of our constitution. And it still is part of the constitution. And basically it divides the country into half, half for the black man and half for the white man. And again, the main reason for this was to protect the black man. Because if we had not introduced that legislation, you can rest assured that the white man with his superior skills and his superior finances would have probably owned 90% of the country today. So to protect the black man, we said no. Now, the position today is still that this protects the black man. Now, I don't deny that the day might come in the future when the position will be reversed, that it will give more protection to the white man. Maybe we'll continue with it then, but I think that will be for a generation after my time to deal with.
When you say protection, what you're saying is that the 50% of the land that is allocated to the white cannot be purchased by a black man, is that it?
And vice versa. And in fact, as far as the black man is concerned, most of that land is held under tribal trust. Mm-hmm. In other words, they don't even have to pay that land. It is just theirs.
Mm-hmm. But now, for instance, could a black man buy a lot in Salisbury?
No, because Salisbury falls in the white man's area. Now, just alongside Salisbury is a place called, just beyond Harare, is an African township where industry is growing now and homes and so on. Well, that is the black man's side of the line, and no white man can buy there. Seki, mm-hmm. A place called Seki. So we have got this dividing line. We admit this. It is something that was agreed to. In fact, originally was the brainchild of the British government. All of a sudden, now that we're independent, it seems to be wrong. Whereas previously, when it was the idea of the British government, and while they were associated with us, it was right. Mm-hmm. We don't understand this sort of double standard, you see.
Okay, now what else are there in the white areas? Are there jobs that are excluded for black Rhodesians?
No.
They can be president of a company or anything?
Yes.
And can they have white subordinates?
Yes.
And what about living patterns? Granted that they're not allowed to own an apartment or a house, can they rent an apartment in any area of Salisbury?
Not in any area. Okay. Again, in certain areas which are set aside for them, mm-hmm. even though it be a European area, we have gone so far as to say that they can buy the land. They can own the land and the houses. And I would like to show you certain areas in Salisbury here where there are Africans who have double, treble story houses with private swimming bars and carport for two and three motor cars.
In white areas? I thought you said
yes.
You couldn't do that.
No, well, they can. One or two small areas that we have set aside and said, all right, you can buy land there. This is a concession.
Experimental.
A concession that we have made.
Now, but I say, but that land is absolutely theirs. It's not something you can take away from them.
No.
Now, what about restaurants? Are they allowed to patronize your restaurants?
Well, this depends on the owner. There is no government interference with this. The same as far as...
I say, there's no law.
...hotels are concerned. If the owner wishes to bring them in, he can.
It's the way it was in America up until 10 years ago, in other words. And what about... bars, for instance.
Same applies to bars.
I see. So therefore, there is no Rhodesian statute that enforces a social segregation other than in the ownership of land in certain areas.
In private life, then, the residents are able to decide whatever they want. As far as the public life is concerned, I would be surprised. I can't think offhand if there are places where the African is restricted. And yet, he was in many areas, say 10 years ago, before we came in as the government. Gradually, there has been a liberalizing of these things. Mm-hmm. And I believe that this is the correct policy, that you must do these things gradually as people wish to accept them. Mm-hmm. I think it is better that something like this comes from the heart than it is enforced by legislation, because if you have to enforce it, then it means it's artificial. Mm-hmm. It would be far better that it was genuine. We do have schools. You mentioned schools earlier on.
Yeah.
I don't want to evade any of your questions. Again, it has always been traditional here that we've had separate schools, the same as the land. And we still have, basically, this position today. And again, we think there are many advantages for the African because, as I mentioned to you earlier, he was left so far behind as far as education was concerned. If they were to come in today into the European schools, I think you would find that they would be way behind the Europeans. And I think this would cause unfair competition and perhaps a certain feeling of inferiority.
How come it works so successfully with your neighbor in Mozambique, where they have integrated primary and secondary schools?
Well, I'm unaware of the fact that it works successfully there. You may be right. But again, I would say to you that for a long time, their policy has been completely different to ours. They have had a policy known as assimilado.
Yeah.
And of course, those people were in Mozambique, I think, 100 years before the white man came to Rhodesia. This is another point.
I see. Let me ask you, you touched for a moment on the fact of terrorism. You are undoubtedly aware that the International Institute for Strategic Studies recently released a projection that you would not, in fact, be able to, your government would not be able to survive protracted guerrilla war. I see that the statistics show that there have been more people, a total of 60 Rhodesians, killed and brutally killed in most cases, than were killed by the Mau Mau in Kenya. So my question is, what kind of response are these terrorists meeting among black Rhodesians? Is there cooperation with them, or are they helping you to resist them, or how does that stand?
Well, no, I'm very happy to tell you, and this is a genuine and an honest assessment, that the terrorists have failed to gain the support of the local people. And that is why, latterly, there has been a change in the direction of the terrorist movement. Originally, it was aimed against the European people, the white people of Rhodesia. Today, it is aimed basically against their own people, the black people. And the vast majority of those that you mentioned, that number, are black people. And because they have been unable to gain their support, they are now turning against their own brothers and murdering them. Excuse me, it's a tragic situation, but the one good thing about it is the fact that it is clear they have not gained the support of the local people.
Now, the two principal organizations manning the terrorist operations are, according to the Washington Post anyway, receiving all of their equipment from the communist nations, in one case Soviet Union, in the other case China. To what extent, first of all, how do you account for the fact that these organizations are receiving aid of some sort for instance, the World Council of Churches, from people in Europe and so on? Is it because you feel that their mission is not clearly understood, that they are purely liberators in the classic style? How do you account for that extraordinary sponsorship?
Well, I think my honest answer to you must be that I'm unable to account for this. I think I'm correct when I say that it is basically the Chinese who are supporting these people. I don't think the Russians are in this one at all. The Chinese have come into Tanzania and to Zambia. Not only do they supply these people with their materials, they also train them in the art of warfare. But how an organization like the Christian Council of Churches can support them, or any Western European government, is beyond my comprehension. I'm afraid I can't answer this.
Well, now, haven't you been having a certain amount of trouble along the Mozambique frontier? And if so, why is it that the Portuguese aren't in a position to successfully patrol and prevent the terrorists from launching attacks from Mozambique?
Well, again, I regret to say that this is something that I'm unable to explain. The terrorists have been gaining ground in Mozambique. I think it is the hope of the people in Mozambique that eventually they will get on top of this. They are embarking on certain policies. It is a fact, I believe, that the completion of the Cabora-Bassa Dam will provide a certain amount of assistance. And we are hopeful that the position will improve there. But at the moment, this is one of our weak points. We were fairly successful in holding the line on the Zambezi, apart from sporadic hit-and-run raids. We now find that these people have come around and have come through Mozambique, and they caught us unawares there. And this has taken us a little longer than we anticipated, but I am completely confident that we will get on top of the problem and solve it.
Have you exercised the right of a hot pursuit?
Yes, this is something which I gather is accepted internationally, and we have this agreement with the Portuguese. It is a mutual agreement.
And what about Zambia?
No, there is no such agreement. In fact, the Zambians boast of the fact that the terrorists use their territory.
What about Botswana?
Now, I don't believe we have the same problem with Botswana, certainly not to date. But this is one of our problems, having one of our neighbors, Zambia, in a situation where they actually support, succor, and aid the terrorists. It's complications.
Have you captured any terrorists?
Oh, yes.
Or only killed them?
No, we've captured a large number of
terrorists. And from what tribes do they tend to come? You say they're not Rhodesians. Are they mercenaries, or ideological mercenaries, paid mercenaries, or...?
No, I think they are people who come from this part of the country, around here to our north, basically.
Zambians?
No, from all around.
They are Rhodesians, then?
Some of them are Rhodesians from this part of the world here, where there are a number of countries that come together. You see, we have a line of demarcation in our northeast here, which is just an imaginary line on a map, one of these things that the white man did when he came here, when he was dividing the country. And there are tribes settled and who've lived all of their lives on both sides of the line, the dividing line. This is the sort of complication that we have.
And what do you think their motivations are? Are they ideological? Are they, liberationist in the classical sense, or what?
I have no doubt that a number of them are political discontents who believe that this is a quick, easy way to get to the top. On the other hand, we do know for a fact, and we've had this from many of the terrorists which we have captured, this is the sort of evidence which has been divulged in our courts here, that they were misled into leaving Rhodesia with promises that they would be given education. They were going to be taken to university in countries like China, Russia, and Algeria. And when they got to these countries, they were thrown into terrorist training camps. And ever since then, they've had somebody behind them, which has put them in a position where they were unable to get out of the predicament in which they found themselves. If ever an opportunity presents itself here, they do get out. A number of them have come across.
Now, you have a country here about the size of California, right? Well, that is right, approximately. With 3,000 military, 3,500, something like that, and 8,000 or 10,000 policemen. How is it possible to patrol these frontiers if, in fact, you are resisting the mounting and pointed resentment of people who have access to the arsenal of Red China? How can you look forward optimistically to that struggle?
Well, fortunately, our task is made easy because of the fact that the mass of the people are on our side, and we don't have to fight the mass of the people. If we did, then the problem would be serious. Mm-hmm. But the mass of the black people are on our side and actually help us. We have many cases where they have personally themselves carried out very brave acts and have arrested terrorists and brought them in.
Why do you have only 1,000 black militia? Since there's obviously a shortage of police manpower.
Well, I'm not sure whether your facts are right, with due respect. I think we probably have more than that. But we have as many as we believe it is necessary. It is a fact that we are now expanding, both black and white. But I'm sure you will understand that this isn't something that you can just do overnight. From
no,
the moment
of course,
we decide to do this, there is a tremendous program of expansion which takes place. And we are now in the process of, for example, doubling our RAR, which is a very famous Rhodesian regiment of black troops, the Rhodesia African Rifles, who have a reputation from the last war and even the war before that. We are now doubling them. Mm-hmm.
To what extent have you relied on South African help?
The South Africans have made a contribution for which we have been very grateful, but it has mainly been a police role on particularly a certain part of the northern borders, where to begin with, we found a subversive African organization which was trying to infiltrate through Rhodesia into South Africa.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it was when that took place that the South Africans suddenly realized that the further north they could throw their protective border, the better. And ever since they have been in with us, and I must make it clear, we're very pleased to have them. It's
sure.
Nice to have your friends standing with you when you've got a bit of a problem.
Sure. I have read that some of the weapons that the terrorists are beginning to use are highly sophisticated. Where will you get complementary weapons?
Well, unfortunately, I can't tell you that one.
But you will get them?
Well, so far, I'm pleased to say that our weapons are superior to the terrorists. And as I see the situation before us, I believe we will be able to maintain this position.
Speaking of these delicacies, what about the sanctions that have been voted against you? To what extent have they been effective?
Well, I think it would be silly of me to claim that they have had no effect at all. But funnily enough, they have had beneficial effects as well as detrimental effects. There is no doubt that the economy of Rhodesia, the base of our economy, has been broadened tremendously because of sanctions. There has been an industrial revolution in Rhodesia. We are now producing and manufacturing goods, which I am told by our industrialists we would not have been doing for another 10 years, for example, had it not been for sanctions. You know, when people are challenged, you always get a greater effort out of them. And moreover, there was a certain amount of protection, of course, that was associated with sanctions. Because we could not get certain articles, the protection was provided, and therefore the industrialists came in and started making these things. To begin with, perhaps not as good as the imported article, but I must say they've improved tremendously to such an extent now that many of these new items, which we were not making previously, we not only provide for our own markets today, we even export, and even to sophisticated countries. So there have been tremendous benefits. But on the other hand, I cannot deny that the economy would have expanded at a greater rate without sanctions. There are people who are trying to drag us back by our shirt tails. We lose a certain amount in the economic field because we have to normally import and export through a third party, and they all take their rake off. So this means that we export at a discount and we import at a premium. Mm-hmm. I think the main detrimental effect is that we now have a larger content of unemployment amongst our black people than we've had before. We've no unemployment among the whites. It is the black people.
Because the whites are the skilled labor pool.
Yes, it is a tremendous demand for them, and we are looking for more skilled people. Mm-hmm. But as far as the mass of the labor is concerned, we have got more of these people offering than we have jobs offering.
Well, now, how do you account for the fact that sanctions have not been voted against South Africa, but were voted against you, when really the South African situation is far more rigid than your own in terms of apartheid?
I don't think this has got anything to do with policies in the country. Sanctions were imposed on us simply because of our UDI. The British government took us to the United Nations and said, Rhodesia have misbehaved themselves. They've declared their independence. They shouldn't have declared independence, so we ask you to impose sanctions on them. It was for this reason and nothing else. Nothing to do with our policy.
If I may beg to disagree with you, having served in the United Nations very recently, I think that they would have been very glad to penalize Rhodesia on almost any pretense. If France had asked for sanctions against Algeria for declaring its independence, I can assure you the United Nations would not have voted them. I think it was a fusion of UDI plus the very heavy control of the United Nations by the Arab African bloc.
Well, you express an opinion, but I can assure you that was not the reason given by the British government when they took our case to the United Nations. That might have been the factor that motivated people for supporting it. Mm-hmm. But in actual fact, Britain took us to the United Nations for one reason only. We declared our independence illegally.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me ask you this. To what extent do you think that the process is reversible? I'll put it this way. Suppose a day after tomorrow you reached an agreement with Great Britain that was endorsed by Bishop Matsuriwa, and the Pierce Commission came along and authenticated it. Do you feel that you could get the Security Council to remit that vote?
Yes, this is an interesting question, and it is one that we have been into many times. We are satisfied that this would not be a real problem, and this is one of the cases where our legal advisers agree with the British legal advisers. They believe that this was done in such a way that the removal of sanctions from the United Nations could be achieved.
Mean that it would not actually come up to a vote of the Security Council?
That is correct.
That it could be done bilaterally?
That is correct. This is because of the mechanics, the manner in which it was introduced.
I see. So, well, let me put it to you very concretely. When you met with Alec Douglas-Hume in the Mediterranean, and you both initialed that document, was it understood that if it was cleared by the Pierce Commission, England would begin instantly to buy Rhodesia?
That is the position.
Without clearing it with the UN?
That is correct.
Oh, that's very interesting. Very interesting indeed.
The first and the vital step that is necessary is to legalize our position, and this can only be done by the British House of Commons.
I see. All right, let me ask you this. Has Bishop Matsuriwa outlined a program which would satisfy him?
Well, we are now in the midst of carrying out discussions, so I'm not in a position.
I don't want you to divulge any confidences. But yeah. I mean, does he have a manifesto that I can read, or that you can read, that says this is what we desire? Presumably, would be exaggerated, but is there a position?
Yes.
To which he is adhered?
Yes, he has stated his case, and we have stated our case, and we are now working on this position.
And his public case, does it ask for instance, an elimination of the literacy requirement?
Well, now you're not trying to get me.
No. I don't want to know. I'm not asking you about the confidential exchanges. I'm asking for his public position.
I regret to say that you won't get much out of me in this particular line, because I have always strictly adhered to my stand with the British and with anybody else, and they have endorsed this stand, that if we attempt to negotiate in public and divulge confidences, then we are going to prejudice a successful outcome of the issue, and I don't want to do that.
That's why I said I didn't want you to divulge confidences. Well, all right, I'll suppose you permit me then to state what Bishop Matsuriwa's stand is. I thought it would be better if you said it. His stand, as I read it in the newspapers a couple of months ago, is that he will settle for nothing less than quote, instant.
My continual advice to people, and it's the advice I give to you, is not to believe what you read in the newspapers, because I find they have very little relation to the facts which confront me.
Well, yeah, I hope I can exempt from that warning that which I write in newspapers.
Accepted.
let me ask you then, finally, because we only have a few minutes, some broad strategic questions. To what extent has your experience here as Prime Minister of Rhodesia convinced you that the West is so much bewitched by the fashionable superstitions of the decade as to be a very unreliable partner in the long run?
Well, I'm not quite sure how to answer your question. It's a pretty complicated world that we live in, isn't it? It's an odd world in many ways. And I would say this to you. I believe we would settle our problem very quickly if the rest of the world would just leave us alone, if they would get out from under our feet. I'm surprised at the number of people who visit Rhodesia, and I include people from your own country, who invariably say to me, the happiest black faces we have ever seen in our lives we find here in your country. We don't understand what the problem is. And my reply is, well, I don't understand what the problem is either. If people would leave us alone, you can rest assured that we would come to an amicable settlement, and I believe we would all live a very happy and a peaceful life in Rhodesia. Because after all, we have got to go on living with the decisions we make, not the people outside who are so ready to advise us. If we accept their advice and everything blows up in Rhodesia, it doesn't worry them when they live 6,000 miles away. This is the greatest guarantee, I believe, that the rest of the world can have as far as our bona fides are concerned, our genuineness, and the fact that we will ensure that we make the right decision is the fact that we have got to go on living with the decisions that we make.
Yeah, but the rest of the world wonders who you refer to when you say, quote, we. If you're referring to 250,000 white people,
no, all Rhodesians. Well, I'm referring to all Rhodesians.
And that's
I repeat, if we can't work with the black people in Rhodesia, there is no future for us. Mm-hmm. I've got enough sense to realize that. I'm a practical man.
Yeah, yeah.
And I say this again to you. We have made tremendous advances and concessions to the black people in advance of what we inherited when we came in as the government about 10 years ago.
Right.
We're never given credit for this for some reason or other. The rest of the world, I believe, wants a revolution. And we have made up our minds we are not going to have a revolution. We want an evolutionary process of bringing these people on.
In connection with your anxiety to be left alone, a doctor, John Hutchinson, Professor John Hutchinson, who was recently here, gave an interview with a Washington paper a month or so ago, in which he said that Rhodesia, your government, would in fact welcome, after you had reached an agreement, sort of a certification of it by the United States, that you would welcome our blessing. Now, isn't this an invitation to an unwanted interference?
Well,
I think he used the term, quoting you, that after it was made legal.
Yes. I don't, strictly speaking, I don't recall the incident. However, let's just take it as a fact. I wouldn't try to detract from a statement that once we have got our independence, it would be very nice to know that the rest of our friends in this world have acknowledged that we have now returned to normality. This is why we want to settle this.
You mean diplomatic recognition, that kind of thing?
Yes. We are ardent members of the free world. I believe the world is divided in two today, the free world and the non-free, or the communist world. We've always supported and fought for the free world, and we are in the incredible position today where our main enemies are our old friends, other members of the free world, namely Britain and the United States of America. And our true enemies, the communists, are just sitting by, rubbing their hands and saying, well, let them get on. And
sending arms to the terrorists.
Of course, we have got this one additional problem. We've got the communist terrorists who are now worrying us on our northern borders. But basically, our main enemies are the people who are imposing sanctions against us. I repeat, our old friends, Britain and America. You can see for yourself if you go around Salisbury today, there are no new American cars. Prior to independence, most of the cars you found in this country were American cars. The other countries in the world are supplying us with our needs, not America and Britain. So our two great friends of the past are now, today, our two greatest enemies. It's a ridiculous and an invidious position, and we would like to get out of it.
Thank you, Mr. Prime Minister.
Thank you really much.
Next week, anti-Castroite Jorge Mas and foreign affairs analyst Tad Schultz join Mr. Buckley for a look at the U.S. position on Cuba. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. That's $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. This program made possible by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.